Hello, welcome back. It's me, Valerie Monroe, and my great friend, Bookwormy. Are you ready to enjoy this tasty book? Well, I'm not going to let you eat it. We're here to enjoy more of Journey to Nag-Wanis, picking up where we left off, which was where? Which was Brogdon heading homeward to tell Finley's wife that Finley is alive and that he delivered the treasure. But then Brogdon was kind of sleepy on the way home and he stopped and took a nap. So we'll pick up from there. Okay, let's read on. Let's read on. Brogdon's body lay still, except for the rising and falling of his chest. Meanwhile, a large group of dark clouds stalked slowly across the night sky and covered the moon. Without its light, the sky changed into a portrait of inky blackness. It was in the darkness that the large, lumpy boulder that Brogdon had run into began to move. Remember when he ran into something? He thought it was a big rock. He didn't realize something alive. If Brogdon had not been so tired when he ran into it, he would have realized that it was neither granite nor quartz nor any of the other types of rock that Aunt Hazel had taught him about. He would have realized that the large lumpy mass was, in fact, not a rock at all, but a huge man covered head to toe with matted hair. If Brogdon had known that, he certainly would not have been dreaming his peaceful, happy dreams. Slowly and cautiously, the larger-than-life hairy man crawled on his hands and knees toward Brogdon. A thin trickle of blood trailed behind him. It was evident that he was in pain. The blackness hid his grimace, but he groaned with each movement. When he reached the small sleeping boy, he sniffed Brogdon up and down, and then he poked Brogdon gingerly with a long hairy finger. Brogdon still did not wake up. Yet, it wasn't until the hairy creature rolled Brogdon on his side and poked him squarely in the stomach that he finally snapped out of his slumber, and he did so rather instantly. Brogdon took one look at the gigantic hairy man and opened his mouth to scream, but no sound came out. He tried over and over again, but all that he could manage was a raspy, airy whistle, which then became a tiny peep. And as much as he wanted to run away, he found himself frozen in place. The hairy man continued to poke Brogdon with one hand while pointing to his own shoulder with the other. His moaning sounded to Brogdon like a low train whistle. "Wait a minute," Brogdon managed to say in a high-pitched squeak. "Are you hurt? 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 Hurt?" A flurry of flapping feathers surrounded Brogdon's head. He could scarcely believe his ears. He would recognize that voice anywhere. It was Che. "Hurt! Hurt! Hurt!" the parrot squawked. "It's true," Brogdon thought incredulously. "Che's alive!" The hairy man turned and looked up at Che, and at that moment, Brogdon could just make out the three arrows that were sticking out of the man's colossal body. The first was embedded in his right shoulder, the second was farther down his back, and the third was dangling from his left ankle. Clumps of matted blood had clotted around the points where each arrow had entered. All three dangled and swayed as the hairy man moved about. Brogdon gently pushed the man's large finger away and sat up. "How did this happen?" he said. "Who did this to you? You must be in terrible pain." "Terrible pain! Terrible pain!" shrieked Che, but the man did not respond. "Perhaps I can. Well, if you hold still, I can try to remove the arrows," suggested Brogdon. "Remove the arrows," Che encouraged. The man nodded and leaned closer. The arrow in his shoulder was closest to Brogdon, so he tentatively reached out and grabbed hold of its tip. He decided that it would be better to yank it out quickly rather than wiggling it around. "Just hold still. This may hurt now, but it will be better in the long run." The hairy man gazed quizzically at him with his bloodshot eyes. He looked exhausted. Brogdon counted to three, and they gave a mighty yank, and the arrow popped out. Then the hairy man howled in pain. Calm down," Brogdon soothed. "A big light guy like you can handle this. Now sit still." He grabbed hold of the arrow lodged in the man's back and pulled. But that arrow proved trickier than the first one, And it took him several tries and a great amount of wriggling back and forth before he was able to remove it. And the hairy man howled and writhed. Finally, the man turned his body so that his ankle was easy for Brogdon to reach. This third arrow seemed to be causing the most pain of all. The hairy man winced and jerked away each time Brogdon put his hands near it. "Calm down, calm down, calm down, calm down," Chase sang out and flapped around the two of them. As soon as Brogdon finally grasped the arrow, he realized the cause of all the pain. It was firmly wedged into the bone. He pushed it one way and then the other, but the arrow did not budge. Brogdon feared that the bone might split if he exerted too much force. He looked apologetically into the hairy man's face. I'm so sorry. The arrow is really stuck in there. I'm afraid I'll cause you even more pain if I pull harder. Pull harder, pull harder, screeched Che. With one swipe of his hairy arm, the huge man flung Brogdon aside and grabbed the arrow himself. Brogdon watched from the nearby bush where he'd landed. As the hairy man pulled and tugged, the struggle seemed to last forever. He paused several times and sucked in air with deep, ragged breaths. Blood flowed from the point where the arrow was stuck, and the hairy man's hand slipped each time he tried to grab it, which in turn caused him to become more frustrated and angry. Finally, he rubbed his huge palm in the dirt, gripped the arrow, and pulled with all his might. At the same time, he let out such a loud bellow that all of the loose feathers on Che's body flew off. This final attempt did the trick. The tip of the arrow popped out. However, as soon as the hairy man put his giant foot down to steady himself, there was an ear-splitting shriek. The bone must have broken in two, Brogdon realized in horror. The hairy man fell to the ground in more pain than ever. His wails and cries tore through the air, and Che uttered a word entirely on his own for the first time, because Che usually just repeats what everybody else says. "Help! Help!" he cried, flapping away in front of Brogdon's face. "Help! Help! Help!" Then he battered Brogdon's head and shoulders with his beak. "Help! Help!" "Okay, okay," yelled Brogdon. "I'll help. Just let me think. Think, think," pled Che. How was he, a boy of 12 inches tall, supposed to help this big hairy man? He couldn't even lift one of the man's hands, let alone get him to his feet. What the hairy man needed was a doctor, someone who knew how to set the bone. Brogdon had never been to a doctor, but he knew that house dwellers visited them, sometimes in places called emergency rooms, which were found in hospitals. He knew this because the last time he had seen John, his friend had had a cast on his arm. He had fallen off a ladder trying to fix part of Maggie's tank. Elaine had insisted that John go to the emergency room to see a doctor, even though he was convinced it was only a bad sprain. That's what the hairy man needs, a cast. If only he could get word to John, Brogdon was sure that he would help. Sure, John might be alarmed at the sight of this strange being, but Brogdon was sure he would not do the hairy man any harm. But how could he get in touch with his friend? And that's where we'll stop for today. Oh, that's a very suspenseful point. We don't know how he'll get help. I think John will help him. He's just got to figure out how to get in touch with John. Well, let's figure that out. But we'll do it tomorrow. We'll do it tomorrow or the next time we read. So please come back and join us again. Join us again and keep on reading.